and you, and you, and you, and you were there. Some of it wasn't very nice, but most of it was beautiful.
Hello, hello.
Howdy. How are you, Bryan?
I'm doing great. You?
I'm doing all right. Welcome back to another installment of Dream Idiots. And Bryan and I are your Dream Idiot hosts. I think I'm going first this week. Is that right, Bryan?
You're up. Hit me with your best shot.
Okay. Strange you should mention that, because this is about that song. No, it's not.
big this, Benatar fan, right? Okay.
Yeah, this is called, it is about a musician, however. I'm calling this The Strange Case of Washington Phillips and the Beautiful Mystery He Bequeathed to the World. So let's talk about Washington Phillips. Have you heard about this name before I brought him up?
I've never heard this name. I have no idea who this is.
So this has been a big mystery the last really 20 years, I guess. Maybe a little bit longer than that. And he's considered a gospel artist, but you might find his albums in blues sections. But he was born somewhere near Fairfield in Freestone County, Texas, which is about 88 miles south of Dallas, 152 miles north of Houston, January 11th, 1880. And he died September 20th, 1954 in Teague, Texas, where he's buried, which is out in the, I believe, the upper kind of northeast part of the state. Now, there are some sources that say he actually died in Austin in 1938 or 1939, but those have been disregarded because he had a namesake in the family, had almost his exact name, who was a second or third cousin. So that was not him. Our Washington Phillips lived until 1954. And he was a preacher, an itinerant preacher who would travel from community to community, and he would sing gospel tunes. And only 16 tracks survive of his music.
Wow.
Which is less than Robert Johnson's, what was left of Robert Johnson. All 16 of them were recorded over 3 years time, every time it was in the month of December, from 1927 to 1929. And Columbia Records put this together in this kind of improvised studio under the direction of Frank B. Walker. He was the producer. I found out about his music for the first time through a great book called Songs in the Key of Z, The Curious Universe of Outsider Music. It's by a guy named Erwin Chusid, who did a radio show up at WFMU. Up in the New Jersey area. And this is a great book that gives you insights into kind of these mysterious musicians that no one really knows much about, folks who've showed up, like John Deck has a big thing in there, and some other lesser known record, the legendary Stardust Cowboy, other folks like that. It's a great book. And when I first heard his music, it's not unlike hearing, and I think this is probably the best way to put it, his music is not unlike the first time that I heard Robert Johnson's original recordings, or for that matter, Daniel Johnston, the Texas outsider for the first time.
Hello, how are you?
Hello. Yeah, that's right. hi, how are you? Yeah, Daniel. I ran into him once at a comic book store in Houston. And
Johnston?
Yeah, he's a big comic book guy. And so I ran into him at Third Planet in Houston one time. And part of me, I was like, don't bother him. No, bother him. Tell him how much you like his music and find out what comics he's buying and that kind of stuff. I didn't talk to him. I left him alone. And after he passed, I was like, eh, maybe I should have said something.
But, oops.
Yeah. Really eerie stuff. I had a guy who lived down the hallway from me, my freshman year in college, from Arizona, named Carl. And Carl was a big Rolling Stones fan. And he introduced me to Robert Johnson's music. And he said, do you ever listen to Robert Johnson late at night on your headphones and get scared? I'm like, yeah, kind of. I can see that's the kind of music that does that. He has been covered, Washington Phillips, our man Washington Phillips, has been covered by Sister Rosetta Tharpe, Will Oldham and the Palace Brothers, the Animal Collective, Mogwai, Gillian Welch, Ry Cooter, and Fish are among the artists who've covered his music at one time or another. Now, I said he had a mystery because no one's really sure for the longest time. I think they figured it out now, but no one was really sure what he played to accompany himself, because it's just vocals and accompanying himself on some kind of stringed instrument. Some folks said it was something called a dociola, which is a zither-like body. It's got 60 wires with a miniature keyboard on one end. It was a tabletop instrument, so you could play the keys and strum if you needed to as well.
Right.
So
like a dulcimer.
Right. You could do the chordal structure, say, by holding the strings down, and then have some kind of melody on the keyboard side of things. There was an ad reproduced in the complete recorded works of Washington Phillips from Yazoo Records, which for many years was the only disc out there of his music. I mean, it's the same 16 tracks over and over again. But it has an advertisement for what they call a miniature grand piano. Now I'm quoting directly from this advertisement. The dulciola is the only musical instrument ever invented that has been demanded and sold in every country upon the globe the first year it was on the market. It is endorsed by leading musicians everywhere, as well as the nobility of Europe. The dulciola, with its four full octaves, embodies the exquisite tone of two guitars and two mandolins. Its action, while similar to that of a piano, is quicker and more simple, permitting effects impossible with a larger instrument. Any class of music can be played. Music lovers are delighted with it. You must own one. And then there's testimony from some folks, Arthur, they don't say whether he's an author of, but author Charles K. Harris, the Princess of Eisenberg, Darmstadt, Germany, and then someone simply referred to as a musical authority of New York, have all called this the new instrument. Now, one of the mysteries is that the way the music sounds, there's no one really knew what it was he was doing. Some folks said that he would assemble who he played for, said that he assembled it there on the spot and it looked like it was made out of different parts. Let's just take a listen to the music here. Bryan, you've got it queued up for us. This is a song called Take Your Burden to the Lord and Leave It There. Let's listen to a few seconds of this and see what we think.
Leave it there. Oh, leave it there. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. If you will trust him and never doubt, he will surely bring you out. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. I have the word from you withhold of its silver and its gold, and you'll have to get along with Major Sam. Just remember in God's word how he fed those little birds. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. I help your body suffer pain, and your health you can't.
That's good. We can. There we go. So, what do you think?
That's super cool. It sounds a lot in my mind like a harpsichord.
Yeah, some people have thought it was a harpsichord.
Right.
It's okay. Got that kind of. I don't know how to describe the sound because I'm not a musician.
Yeah, me neither.
It's this harp-like, kind of. Well. Let's get back to my text here. What folks think today is that he was playing something called a mandzarine, which some folks have said is basically two zithers that were perhaps attached together to allow chordal and melodic structures to a song. So you play the chords on one side and you play the melody on the other. So it's a double-sided zither, if you will. There's a guy named Greg Miner and someone named Kelly Williams who have an exhaustive history of this evolution of thinking by musicologists as to what exactly Phillips was playing. Miner and Williams relied on the experiments and contributions of the late Gary Harrison. He collected fretless zithers, and he was a traditional music performer. And it was Harrison's work that led to this dual zither theory. Now, in 2018, the music you heard, it's one of 16 cuts that's available out there. Like I said, it's been repackaged several times. But in 2018, an album entitled Washington Phillips and His Mandzarine Dreams was nominated for 2 Grammys, Best Historical Album and Best Album Notes, because they went through the entire history of
right, sure.
You know, what they thought was going on with his music. And of course, immediately a group of his fans, because he was nominated, immediately called him a sellout, and they said he liked his early stuff better. that didn't happen. But regardless of what instrument was that he played, he left us 2 things. One, I love a mystery. And I love the fact that there are still things that we haven't figured out in the world and in the universe. This has been one of those little mysteries that I've kind of thought about since I discovered that album way back in, when did I get that? Sometime in the early 2000s, I picked up this Washington Phillips. I think I bought it when I was still living in New York. He left this incredible collection of 16 tracks, just, you know, very small body of work. That has been described by, and I'm quoting from a variety of music critics, haunting, otherworldly, eerie, ethereal, and Elysian. I call it timeless. I call it absolutely timeless. It sounds like it's coming from another planet, another time and another place. And I can't say there's been anything else like it that I've really heard that has dropped my jaw the first time I heard it in terms of traditional American music. It's one that just kind of leaves me. I listened to this collection several times while writing this story, so it was always on in the background. And I'm not the biggest fan of gospel music. I have a few gospel albums in my collection, but it's really remarkable stuff, I think. What are your impressions of it?
No, it's definitely very, you know, very cool. The sort of the origins of Americana and gospel and roots music. I mean, my knowledge of it is by no means encyclopedic. I do like a lot of the, you know, the music that obviously came later, 50s and 60s and so on. But it is definitely you know, very ethereal. It's very, very cool though. But again, you're right though. I can't think of when you talk about, you know, Etta James or some vocalists that are not as old as he is, but you know, not too far after. I mean, there's nothing really that comes to mind that I would say sounds similar.
No,
but I'm not really sure why.
You know, because when you get to like one of my favorites, Sister Rosetta Tharpe, you know, she was one of the first rock and rollers,
right?
And Bob Dylan always said, she's my favorite guitarist, because she was a heck of a guitarist, and she had similar themes from a gospel nature, but in a secular world. Things like strange things are happening every day. I hear music in the air. But yeah, nothing else to me sounds quite like this. The album that I used and album notes that I used for some of this work was by Pat Conti. He wrote the album notes for Washington Phillips. And the collection I have is called I Am Born to Preach the Gospel from Yazoo Records in 1991. CNN.com had a nice piece called Washington Phillips Gospel's Great Disappearing Act, written by Daniel Burke in December of 2016. Spectrumculture.com had an article called Washington Phillips and His Manzarine Dreams, written by John Paul in December 1st, 2016. Your radio station, Bryan, KUT.org.
Nice.
Washington Phillips and His Manzarine Dreams, A Mysterious Texas Gospel Artist Resurfaces by Trevor Young. In January of 2018, KUT.org is the public radio station broadcasting out of University of Texas, correct?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, we used to trade programming with them back when we had to ship reel-to-reels back and forth in the 80s and 90s.
back you know, shortly after the Punic Wars when things were still on reel-to-reel.
No, I remember from KUT, because KUT, we used to get, we'd either send it to them or get from them music from the Hearts of Space.
Hearts of Space, yeah.
Yeah, we would get that one. Minormusic.com. This is the Greg Minor and Kelly Williams work I was telling you about. Has a great article called The Instruments of Washington Phillips, written originally or published originally in May 2003, but with updates in September of 2015. Erwin Chusett's 2000 book, Songs in the Key of Z, The Curious Universe of Outsider Music, Acapella Press, and Wikipedia for basic article on basically Freestone County in that part of Texas, because I'd never heard of Freestone County. I mean, Texas has so many counties, but for basic information on Phillips and Freestone County and Fairfield, Texas.
Nice.
So there you go. Just a little clip of history there. And you know, I'm kind of reminded it just occasionally Texas crops up because some really important stuff was recorded in Texas. Robert Johnson's, a lot of his stuff was recorded at the Blue Bonnet Hotel in San Antonio.
Yeah, I knew that.
Yeah. And then, and the rest were in Dallas, and same here, his material was all recorded in Dallas. So anyway, there you go. The mysterious Mr. Phillips and the beautiful mystery he left the world.
Excellent. Thank you. We're going to talk a little bit about a woman named Henrietta Lacks. So Henrietta Lacks was born, her birth name was Loretta Pleasant, born August 1st, 1920. She was born in Roanoke, Virginia. She apparently was a small woman. She was barely 5 feet tall. She liked to dress nicely. She favored painted nails and pleated skirts. And no one seems to know why her name was changed from Loretta. Her mother died young after giving birth to her 10th child, and Henrietta bounced around quite a bit and lived with grandparents. Many years later, she would marry her first cousin, a guy named David Lacks, She had her first child at the age of just 14 in 1934. That's too early. She would eventually have five children. And when she wasn't raising them, she was working in tobacco fields in Virginia. So January 29th, 1951, Lax goes to Johns Hopkins, and it's the only hospital in the vicinity that treated Black patients. She went because she was she felt a knot in her womb, she said. She had previously told family about the knot, and they had assumed, correctly as it turned out, that she was pregnant. This was child number five. So after giving birth to Joseph in 1935, Lax had a severe hemorrhage, and her main doctor tested her for syphilis. That came back negative, and they referred her back to Johns Hopkins. There she had a doctor named Howard Jones who took a biopsy of her cervix and found a mass there. She was then told that she had malignant epidermoid carcinoma of the cervix. It turns out decades later, 1970, after subsequent analysis, she'd actually been misdiagnosed. She actually had adenocarcinoma, but it would have scarcely have mattered as the treatment for both of these cancers in the 1950s was exactly the same. So Lax is 31 years old, and she is treated for this cancer with radium tube inserts. I actively chose not to look up radium tube inserts because something tells me it's awful. You know, this is cancer treatment 70 years ago, but she got this treatment at the time as an inpatient. She was discharged a few days later. She was given instructions to return a few days later for an x-ray. During her treatments, two samples were taken from Lax's cervix without her permission or her consent. One was a sample of healthy tissue, and the other one was cancerous. These samples were then given to a guy named George Otto Gay, G-E-Y. Gay is a physician at the time, and he's a researcher, cancer researcher at Johns Hopkins. So it's important to remember at this time, scientists, they're trying to keep human cells alive, you know, in culture form. And they've been trying to do this for decades, but these cultures die. Henrietta's were different. They reproduced an entire new generation of cells every 24 hours, and they never stopped. They're not really technically immortal, but they're called the first ever immortal human cells ever grown in a laboratory. And they became known as the HeLa, H-E-L-A, the first initials of her first and last name, the HeLa immortal cell line. And they are now in 2022, even now, still very commonly used in biomedical research.
You mean her specific cells that have been
her specific cells? Yes. From Henrietta. Her cells have been critical in a whole host of medical research. Jonas Salk used them working on polio. A guy named Chester Southam was a virologist, started using it with cancer patients. Prison inmates have used treatments featuring her cells extensively. Her cells have been in high demand, and they were basically put into mass production. And they are used in a whole host of medical and just frankly countless scientific pursuits. They have been successfully cloned. In 1955, they were used to test human sensitivity to tape and glue and cosmetics and other products. And to date, they are there are a total of 11,000 patents involving Henrietta's original cells.
Holy shit.
Yeah. And she had no idea. This, you know, never gave consent. So in the early 1970s, a huge portion of other cells in some laboratory became contaminated with Henrietta's cells. And so as a result of this, Henrietta's
family. Again, she had five children, and I'm not sure how many grandchildren, you know, very, very large extended family. Henrietta's family started to receive solicitations from researchers wanting them to basically donate genetic material so they could differentiate the HeLa contaminated cells from the cells that were not contaminated with her cells. But until 1975, no one in her family had any idea that her cells were still alive, being used in any form or fashion whatsoever. Right.
So they basically get a letter saying, remember that stuff we stole from your family a while back, the genetic material? Well, we need some more of it. And they're like, wait, what? What did you steal from when? Who?
Yeah. Uh-huh. So, you know, a number of her family members are, to say that they are alarmed would be putting it mildly. They're pissed off. They're confused. They're getting telephone calls, requesting samples. And I mean, they had no idea. We're not privy to any of this whatsoever. And now they start to ask questions about, you know, what did you do? Why did you do it? How much money has been made off of all this? And to say that they are reticent to get involved and are questioning the motives of the people that are calling them would be putting it mildly. So to shift gears here a little bit, I didn't want to have to rewrite a portion of the story, because there's a writer who's already dived into this topic quite a bit and who wrote something here that is better than I could ever possibly conceive of. There's a writer named Rebecca Skloot. She is a fairly prominent science writer. She would, in 2010, she released a book called The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks. And there are numerous articles about Lacks on NPR and nature.org and several other sites. But this is, she wrote the book on Henrietta, and this is taken from a February 1st, 2010 article on NPR from Rebecca. Rebecca is almost exactly our age, 50-ish, was in college in the late 80s. And she talks about having gone to, I believe, a freshman biology class when she was an undergrad, and goes to a lecture. And this prof's name is a Dr. Deffler. And so this is me quoting Rebecca Skloot, quoting Deffler. Deffler says, "We learned that by studying cancer cells in culture," he basically, as part of this lecture, he writes in huge letters on the chalkboard the name Henrietta Lacks. Deffler goes on to say, "Henrietta's cells have now been living outside her body far longer than they ever lived inside it. Her cells went to almost any cell culture lab in the world, and if you opened any of their freezers, you would find..." This is late 80s, "you would find millions, if not billions, of Henrietta's cells in small vials on ice." Again, quoting Skloot from NPR.org, quote, "Henrietta's cells were part of research into the genes that cause cancer and those that suppress it. They helped develop drugs for treating herpes, leukemia, influenza, hemophilia, and Parkinson's disease. They've been used to study lactose digestion, sexually transmitted diseases, appendicitis, human longevity, mosquito mating, and the negative cellular effects of working in sewers. Their chromosomes and proteins have been studied with such detail and precision that scientists know their every quirk. Like guinea pigs and mice, Henrietta's cells have become the standard laboratory workhorse." Again, Skloot now quoting Deffler again, "HeLa's cells were one of the most important things that have ever happened in medicine in the last 100 years. Then, matter-of-factly, almost as an afterthought," Deffler says, "she was a black woman," unquote, "then erased her name off the chalkboard in one fast swipe and blew the chalk from his hands."
Wow.
So this writer, Rebecca Skloot, dives into Henrietta's life in detail. As a result of her research, befriends and enters into a lengthy relationship, business relationship with Henrietta's, I believe, eldest daughter, Deborah, in order to understand Henrietta's story in greater detail and really try to tell that story and you know, honor her legacy and make sure that her story is better known. In 1999, one of Henrietta's granddaughters took an intro biology class and realized at one point that she was holding a vial with her grandmother's cells.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So this is, you know, just an unreal case. They have apparently made some money off of this later on. Not that money is the end all be all of things, but the National Institutes of Health have signaled that they want to make changes to what's called the Common Rule, which is the set, broadly speaking, it's the set of policies that protect the rights of human participants in research. So even if donors have been de-identified in this research, those that have whose DNA or, you know, whose material is in the study, they still have to give consent to being in the study. You know, this woman was only born in 1920. I mean, I'm not saying she would have lived to be 100, but if she were alive today, she'd be 102. There is a program, an initiative, whatever, called HeLa 100 that is basically tied to her legacy, that her children and grandchildren have endeavored to push along to honor her legacy. There are a number of medical conferences that are basically held in her name. There are statues in honor of Lax at the University of Bristol and at Johns Hopkins. And there is, you know, if you Google her name, there is a little bit on the Johns Hopkins website and other things that have been published under the Hopkins name. And it's sort of funny to look at that a little bit, because at least in my mind, when you read it, it is very careful to laud Henrietta's contributions, et cetera, while simultaneously seemingly making the argument that taking samples in this way was common practice at the time. And so it's kind of the, yeah, she's great. But and by the way, we didn't really do anything that was that bad. At least that's how I sort of read it. Anyway, yeah, her story, I mean, by virtue of the book that Skloot writes in 2010, the book was turned into a documentary and then a movie that starred, Oprah actually starred as Deborah Lax, Henrietta's daughter. So the book came out in 2010, the movie came out in 2017. And there's quite a bit on YouTube and elsewhere about Henrietta and her legacy. But again, this is not unlike your story. You know, another just classic example of, you know, a repressed group being completely taken advantage of. And even when and her family was given an opportunity, you know, they could have, those that are making money off of her could have come forth and tried to do the right thing decades before. And her family only found out about this because those same researchers were going back to them again, looking for more information, more DNA. So anyway, you know, a very, very, I think, important, critical, interesting story of a woman who is only now sort of getting her due, even though she had no idea. But somewhere in the research, it says that this material has been replicated so much that, you know, a single cancer cell weighs effectively nothing, but it has been reproduced so many times that if you weighed everything that has been made from her DNA, it would weigh 50 million metric tons.
Okay. I don't even know where to go now. That's is it my turn yet?
You're up.
So I want to start this off by giving special thanks to a Lyft driver I had a while back whose name is Bryan, but he spells it the regular normal way.
Not your way. Right.
Right. So
his mother doesn't love him. I know. That's fine.
So Bryan related this story to me, not our Bryan, but I was telling him about our Bryan's Wyoming baseball story from episode 33, the Wyoming Penitentiary All-Stars. Mm-hmm. And Bryan, the Lyft driver, attended the University of Wyoming, where he played football for the Cowboys in the mid 70s. University of Wyoming Cowboys. Oh. And so I want to tell you the story of the Wyoming Black 14. Have you heard this story?
No.
Okay. So the Wyoming Cowboys were riding a high tide of three straight Western Athletic Conference championships and started the 1969 season off 6-0. Pretty good. They were ranked 16th in the nation, and they led the entire nation in rushing yards. So that's not bad.
That's great.
Game four of that six-game winning span was a home contest against the Brigham Young University Cougars. Okay, from
okay, sure,
good old BYU. Now, the Black Student Alliance at the University of Wyoming called for a protest against the racial policies of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, and I'll get to that in a moment. The chancellor of the BSA, the Black Student Alliance, was a doctoral math student named Willie Black, and he wrote a letter to the University of Wyoming president and the athletic director explaining the group's plan to demonstrate to the BYU game. He wrote, quote, "Our humanity demands that all people of goodwill, whatever their color, athletes included, protest this policy." He also called for the university and the Western Athletic Conference, I'll refer to that as the WAC from here on out, to stop using, quote, "student monies and university facilities to play host to BYU." Because, he argued, to do otherwise would, quote, in part, sanction those inhuman and racist policies. So 14 Black players on the Wyoming football team approached the head coach, Lloyd Eaton, before that October 18th game, and they wanted to discuss this issue with him. The players asked if they could wear Black armbands in order to protest basically two things. One was their treatment by BYU fans in the previous season's game played in Provo, Utah. Okay, so they were yelled at, racial epithets were flying freely, as you might imagine. Now, what I've got to say is, from my standpoint, okay, having lived in Utah for 6 years, Utah sports culture in the 90s, so I can't imagine what it was like in the 70s, was awful. The one Jazz game mm-hmm. I went to was filled with racial epithets. There was this story on the news affiliate, the NBC affiliate, I think it was KSL, Channel 5, ran a Karl Malone story where they were interviewing one of the courtside season ticket holders, right? Mm-hmm. Right there down on the floor.
Right.
And he actually said on TV, he said, because they were talking about Carl's contract negotiations and how it was going to be difficult. And the guy actually said, "Carl's like a big old dog you have chained up in your backyard." He snarls and snaps and some other nonsense. But I'm sitting with my mouth open going, did you just compare a Black man to a chained up animal on the news? Is that what you just did? I heard a lot of anti-gay slurs at U of U, embarrassingly U of U basketball games. And then one time during the fall contest between BYU and Utah, a couple of students of mine went down for the game, which was always around Thanksgiving. And afterwards I saw them and I said, "Hey, how was the game?" And I think they were a pair of sisters. And apparently this woman approached them and yelled and called them a bunch of Utah whores.
Oh.
Because they were wearing their Utah. And then the best part was, so she screams that at them, and then she says, and then my student says, "And she said that in front of her grandchildren." So in general, they're protesting the way that BYU fans are treated in the year before, mainly with racial epithets.
Right.
The second thing they were protesting was the policy of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, which forbade Black people from the priesthood in the church. Or, and I didn't know this part, even entering the temple. You couldn't even enter the temple in Temple Square.
You couldn't walk into the temple if you're Black.
Nope.
In 1969, 70?
This is 69. This policy changed in 1978, some 9 years after the events I'm describing here. There were even policies, Bryan, against having Black scout leaders in LDS-operated Boy Scout troops. Okay, so that's what they went to their coach with, saying, "Hey, we would like to protest this." And they wanted to do it by wearing Black armbands, basically. Now, the Cowboys had a strict no protesting policy. After meeting with the players a second time, Eaton dismissed all 14 of them from the team unilaterally. The Cowboys beat BYU 40-7, which led to the belief that the team would be just fine without the 14 missing players. The demonstration that was held outside the stadium during the game was very peaceful. In fact, Laramie Police Chief Vernon Brazili said of the students and the demonstration, quote, what I want these kids to understand is that we're here to protect them, not to fight with them. Their fight is with the university. All the football players on the team are good kids, both black or white ones, real gentlemen. Another coach we had used to bring in ex-convicts to play, real hoodlums, always drunk, always in trouble. I'm glad these kids today are different. Interesting. And kind of a callback to your story about the convicts and all-stars of the baseball team.
Right, sure.
Now, they also defeated San Jose State at home the next following game. This is a weird season because they had five of their game. They had their five home games all in a row and then five road games to end out the season, which I don't know if that's a thing bizarre, back then or what. The San Jose State Spartans football team had been petitioned by another group calling itself the Committee for the 14. And the committee asked San Jose State to boycott their game against the Cowboys. The school decided to go ahead and play the game, but they wore armbands of their own in solidarity with the Black 14 at the Wyoming game. San Jose State's a great school. One of the smartest people I've ever known went to graduate school at San Jose State. And, you know, to me, it's just reflective of this community around it supported Eaton and the decision.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like a 3-1 margin, they supported what the coach decided. Here's some quotes from the members of the Black 14. These are from Joe Williams, who's a co-captain. "We wanted to see if we could wear black armbands in the game or black socks or black X's on our helmets. And he, the coach, had said no. If he had said no, we would be willing to protest in nothing but our black skins." Second quote from Joe Williams. "He came in, sneered at us, and yelled that we were off the squad. He said our very presence defiled him." Tony McGee. I'm sorry?
Nothing good.
Tony McGee, and one source I have spells it M-C-G-E-E, and another one I have spells it M-A-G-E-E. So Tony McGee said, "Coach said we could, quote, go to Grambling State or Morgan State. We could go to Colored Relief. If anyone said anything, he told us to shut up. We were really protesting policies we thought were racist." Willie Highsaw is quoted as saying, "He said it was stupid of us to be protesting against a faith and religion none of us knew about." Talk about stupid. Do you know that Ted Williams, not the baseball Ted Williams, there was a Ted Williams that was one of the 14 who was protesting, was a Mormon himself. Okay, so comes from Willie Highsaw. The coach's responses. And it's not like Eaton was, I can't figure this guy out because he earned a master's degree. He was a smart dude. He started doctoral studies. I'm not sure if he ever finished. He was in his eighth year as Wyoming's head coach. So I don't, if this is generational stubbornness or what.
Right.
But his quotes were, "It was simply a matter of discipline, black or white, I don't care. They broke the rules and I told them they were no longer members of the team." And then he said, "We've played Brigham Young for many years. Why haven't we had demonstrations before? And we've had Negro players since 1960. I'll tell you why. This is the first year the Black Student Alliance has been on campus. Now they're organized and ready to act. The Western Athletic Conference was picked because of BYU, and we were picked as the trigger because of our rule against demonstrations. It all fits." The governor got involved, and he met with the university trustees, and they all backed the coach. This season ended on a 4-game losing streak, so they ended up 6-4. The Wyoming Cowboys went 1-9 the next year and had only one winning season in the 1970s. The Wyoming Black 14 injustice steered black players away from Wyoming for years. In 2018, a mural honoring the Black 14 was unveiled in downtown Laramie. In 2019, on the 50th anniversary of their dismissal, eight surviving members of the Black 14 were invited back to Laramie in an attempt for the university to make amends. The players were presented with a formal apology written by university president at the time. They were also invited to give speeches in history classes and meet with the current student athletes. A sculpture of a football player's arm, you can tell because it's got the uniform on it, raised upward in a clenched fist, stands in the field house of the University of Wyoming. The plaque reads Black 14 with the names of the players listed in double column below the list, the year 1969. The Black 14 are Jerry Berry, Tony Gibson, John Griffin, Lionel Grimes, Mel Hamilton, Ron Hill, Willie Highsaw, Jim Isaac, Earl Lee, Don Meadows, Tony McGee, Ivy Moore, Joe Williams, and Ted Williams. So, any thoughts?
Well, on that story? Institutional racism is here and here to stay. The fact that this coach tried to say that he would have disciplined anyone who is breaking the rule is obviously horseshit, because his threat were, you know, he's screaming at them, go play at Grambling State, which is, you know, historically black university. I mean, it's mm-hmm. I mean, it's the same. I don't know. I mean, things are better now than they were, maybe slightly, but it's nakedly obvious to me, not every day of my life, but pretty routinely, that you and I have no idea what it's like to deal with racism, because we're not dealing with it. We're not facing it. I mean, I was sort of blown away. I don't even know why I saw this, you know, up late at night when you have that ADD thing and you can't sleep. There is a video that Donald Glover posted. And so he's, you know, musician, comic, you know, he's an extremely prominent, you know, individual. And it's a video of him. I think all he's trying to do is get into, he's late or he's locked out of the venue where he's supposed to be performing that night. And he goes over to this police officer and says, yeah, I'm supposed to be in this building right now and I can't find a way in. I'm supposed to be on stage here in about 7 minutes. And all the cop says is, sir, get off the sidewalk. And he's like, well, officer, I'm, you know, get off the sidewalk. And then it's very, very clear to him that it's going to be a big ass problem here. I didn't hear, you know, the video cuts off. I didn't hear how it was resolved or how he got in or if he got in, but you know, all these fucking police stops, all these ridiculous incidents where, you know, this endless amount of horseshit just continues and continues and continues, where, you know, walking while black, driving while black, is still going on. And so it's just, you know, insane and incredibly, it just makes my skin crawl.
And going back to the coach's quote, when he starts talking about the Black Student Alliance and blaming the problem on them, anytime people, minorities of any kind, are organizing into, hey, let's stand up for ourselves, let's do this, this kind of stuff happens, right? I mean, look at the way the Black Lives Matter treatment. Oh, they're a bunch of communists. They're a bunch of socialists.
Right.
They're anarchists. They're terrorists. I mean, it's same song, different tune. And some of the things I just want to talk about real quick is just the increasing ability on the right to just absolutely bald-facedly tell Black players to shut up and play. And they're the same silly assholes who defend Aaron Rodgers and his asinine behavior regarding vaccines. It's like, look, if you're not vaccinated, just tell us. I mean, don't do this. Don't, you know, don't play along, everybody. And they argue that, well, he's taking a stance. He's standing up for what he believes in. Well, so are these guys.
So was Colin Kaepernick. All he did was kneel.
He's down here on my list, but, you know, these folks wear the I stand for the flag and kneel for the cross t-shirts.
Right. These colors don't run and America rocks. And
this is just nonsense, where it's like the most American thing you can do is protest when conditions are horrible for people. These folks got mad when the Major League Baseball suspended pitcher John Rocker for his public use of racial slurs against immigrants, people of color, the LGBTQ community. I mean, and in his defense, again, Rocker may have not been an asshole, but he was certainly behaving like one at the time, right? Well, it's his free speech. It's like, well, actually, Major League, according to capitalist rules now, they're not Congress. Major League Baseball can do what they want because he's an employee. Or a more personal example for me, the way most of my family feels about NBA head coach Greg Popovich, the San Antonio Spurs, right? Here's a guy who tells it like it is. He's an educated dude. I mean, he speaks couple languages, one of them Russian, which is extremely difficult.
Right.
Air Force graduate.
Well, yeah, multiple degrees. I mean, he has a master's degree in
something. I don't
education,
know.
I think.
He's smart dude. He's won 5 NBA championships.
Shut up and coach.
They despise it. Shut up and coach. They despise him because of his politics, because he dared to say, hey, you know what? Colin Kaepernick, he's doing the right thing. I mean, people are getting murdered every day. And it's kind of like the whole thing about burning the flag. It's like, if the flag has been, we should burn the flag when it's just been dishonored, when it touches the ground, when it's no longer, usable.
Right. Sure.
Well, to some people, the burning is the most symbolic thing you can do, because in a way you're showing respect for it, because, hey, the institutions that represent this flag have corrupted it. And, you know, the same types of folks who dislike Colin Kaepernick for his protest are now the ones that are calling the FBI thugs and villains. So you just can't win with these kind of folks.
I forget what episode we delved into this. I mean, we've talked broadly about Dunning-Kruger and just this, that broad, I'm not qualified to speak on this at all, but, you know, Dunning-Kruger basically is the approach that says my ignorance is just as good as your knowledge. Kind of. It's, you know, this random horseshit that I believe that I read on one website trumps, if you'll excuse the pun, all the information that you've read on 100 websites. Just today there was some, I skimmed this story only because it pissed me off. There's some random dude who was a rabid QAnon Trump person who finally fell off the wagon and shot his wife and adult daughter because Trump lost, and the hinges just fell off the bus, and he just lost his damn mind, and then fired at police, and police killed him. I mean, pull your head out of your ass. I mean, seriously, what is your fucking problem at this point? Sometimes facts are just facts, and sometimes you're wrong. And so, you can't go through life as a fucking toddler and just insist that your worldview or your belief system or your whatever is true in spite of this overwhelming tsunami of contrary evidence. But, in 2022, we're living in a world where that's somehow deemed fine, acceptable. I don't get it.
As a coda, here's a little something that will probably wrap this up. Maybe not as nicely and neatly as I would like to, but I'd like to return to the day of the demonstration of October 16th, 1969. The police chief that I quoted earlier, Vernon Brazili, he saw a young black woman holding a sign which read the following words: "Something is happening here, but you don't understand what it is, do you?" And someone standing next to the chief said, "I guess that sign says it all." And Brazili's response was, "Yeah, I guess so." And of course, her sign, that's a paraphrased lyric of Bob Dylan's from Ballad of the Thin Man, which is, "Something is happening here, but you don't know what it is, do you, Mr. Jones?" Right? So there is something happening here. And are we going to get to the point where we look at the reality and say, this is what's going on? This is what's going on. I mean, what is it that you're defending when you're yelling at people about standing up for people who are being oppressed and killed? It's beyond me. And every time you think we turn a corner, someone somewhere behaves like an asshole, and it just stuns me. So I really like this story on the Black 14, because it illustrates so many things about our culture and what these guys went through. And only three of them returned to play the next year. Three freshmen returned to play.
Oh, wow.
And the rest of them went elsewhere. So that is the story of the Wyoming Black 14 of 1969. And again, thanks to Bryan, the Lyft driver, and Bryan, my podcasting partner, for getting us through this story. Sources for this were... a lot of sources here. Daughter number 3.blogspot.com. Personal conversation with Bryan the Lyft driver. Sports Illustrated's Vaults, No Defeat, Loads of Trouble from November 3rd, 1969. The Eugene Register Guard from Oregon had an article titled "Wyoming Faction Asks for Support from SJS." That's from October of 1969. WYOhistory.org. It's WyomingHistory.org. They got some great pictures in there too on that website of the players and the murals and all those things I talked about. And then of course Wikipedia for basic information on Coach Eaton and the University of Utah football program. And that is that.
Excellent. Not that funny, but to sort of commemorate that day, MLK Day, I wanted to talk about a perhaps lesser known African-American person who is, I think, should be heralded and celebrated as a person who accomplished a lot in a time in this country when probably, even more so than, you and I can't even imagine the obstacles that Black people and women in this country face every day in 2023, let alone what they may have faced over 100 years ago. So we're going to talk today briefly about a woman named Bessie Coleman. Bessie was born 131 years ago, January 26th, coming up here, January 26th of 1892. She was born in a small town called Atlanta, Texas, which I'd never even heard of before. It's right up there near Texarkana. Tiny little town. She was the 10th of 13 children, born to George Coleman, who was a mixed African-American who had Cherokee grandparents. More on that in a bit. And her mother was Susan Coleman, who was African-American. And nine of her siblings survived to adulthood, which apparently was pretty common at the time. When she was 2 years old, she moved to Waxahachie, Texas, a town I'm sure you and I know well. Mm-hmm. they lived there as sharecroppers. Coleman began attending school there at the age of six. She walked 4 miles each day to her segregated one-room school. She loved to read. She was good at math, and she completed her elementary education at that school. How the hell you segregate a one-room school, I don't quite know, but I guess they managed to maintain their racism.
Do you hang a line of laundry down the middle?
Something. What? Yeah, there must be a curtain, or some kids are always outside. Every year, her routine was school chores, but every year the routine was interrupted by the cotton harvest. They were sharecroppers. 1901, George Coleman, the father, leaves the family. He goes to Oklahoma, which was then known as Indian territory. So he went back to, other family there, I judge, and she never sees him ever again. Wife and children did not follow, so they still stay there. At the age of 12, Bessie goes to the Missionary Baptist Church School on scholarship. And when she turned 18, she took her savings and enrolled briefly at, I can't believe this was the name of a school, but this was the name of the school, the Oklahoma Colored Agricultural and Normal University in Langston, Oklahoma. It's now just called Langston University. But she only completed one term before she ran out of money and she had to go back home. 1915, she's 23 years old. She moves to Chicago, where she lives with two of her brothers. She finds a job as a manicurist at the White Sox barbershop, which I assume must have been close to the White Sox field at the time. And she had clientele there. I mean, Chicago was a big and booming city. I'm sure it must have blown her away compared to Waxahachie. But she heard tales from pilots coming back from World War I about their exploits in the air, their exploits as pilots. She took a second job as a restaurant manager of a chili parlor, and she wanted to save money because she wanted to become a pilot. The problem that you have probably already anticipated is that flight schools in America at the time did not admit women and did not admit Black people, and so she was sort of doubly cursed on that front. But there was a guy named Robert S. Abbott that she someone became friends with. He was the publisher of the Chicago Defender newspaper, and he encouraged her to study abroad. He later basically became one of her financial sponsors, along with a Chicago banker, a guy named Jesse Bingham. So she's still in Chicago, has dreams of becoming a pilot. She takes a French language class at the Berlitz Language School in Chicago. And then November 20th, 1920, she gets on a boat, sails across the Atlantic to France, and starts to learn how to fly. She starts to learn in a plane called the Newport 564. It's a biplane with, quote, a steering system that consisted of a vertical stick, the thickness of a baseball bat in front of the pilot, and a rudder bar at the pilot's feet, unquote. Just 6 months, 8 months later, June 15th, 21, Coleman becomes the first Black woman and the first Native American to earn an aviation pilot's license, and the first Black person and first Native American to earn an international aviation license from the Fédération Aéronautique Internationale in Paris. She wants to keep studying. She spends two more months there in Paris studying with some other pilots in the area. September 21, she sails back to America. And she is, she's basically heralded as a kind of a media sensation when she comes back. The problem is, though, this is 1921, and there's not really money to be made as a pilot. There's not air mail. There's no commercial flights yet. This is before Amelia Earhart. This is before Charles Lindbergh. She's a bit of a celebrity, but she doesn't really see a way to make any money. So she decides that she has to go back to Europe for more training. So she goes back in February 22, sails back for Europe, does more training in both near Paris, and then also goes to the Netherlands and studies for a period of time with a guy named Anthony Fokker, who's no relation to the movie of that name, as far as I know. But she traveled to Germany, visited the Fokker Corporation, F-O-K-K-E-R.
No relation to that either?
No idea. I didn't dive that far into it, but she basically wanted to learn how to, become a better pilot. And she was launching a career in what's called exhibition flying. She was going to become a barnstormer. So somewhere in this window of time, she is given the nickname Queen Bess. And she was an incredibly popular draw when she comes back to the States. She's written about quite a bit. She's in the press. Reporters like to write about her. She's quite personable. She's well respected and admired by Blacks and whites, wherever she goes. She mostly flew a biplane called a Jenny. It's a Curtis JN-4, and then would occasionally also fly other aircraft as necessary, because they were kind of surplus airplanes around, left over from World War I that hadn't been used in combat. Made her first appearance September 3rd, 1922, at an event on Long Island honoring the all-black 369th Infantry Regiment of World War I. It was held at the Curtis Field on Long Island near New York. And it was sponsored by her friend Abbott and the newspaper. And Coleman was billed as the world's greatest woman flyer, featured exhibitions from her and from eight other pilots, including a black parachutist, a guy named Hubert Julian. A few weeks later, she goes back to Chicago, does an air show there, this time honoring World War I's 370th Infantry Regiment. Sure, her skills are definitely getting better and better. She does all these daredevil maneuvers, figure eights, loop-de-loops, these near-ground dips, very, very close to the crowd, and the place just freaks out and goes nuts for her. So she definitely is, she's not a minor celebrity. She, at the time, she's definitely, garnering a lot of attention, gets a lot of admiration. I'm sure that the buzz of having cheering crowds, is thrilling for anyone. But she hasn't lost her sight, her goal of becoming, making something of herself, basically. She would be occasionally criticized for being opportunistic, from being flamboyant, and she definitely, liked the attention. But she was also, those that wrote about her couldn't deny the fact that she was confident and capable, and she would do nothing to prevent herself from learning a difficult stunt or gaining a skill. She did have a couple of crashes. She broke her leg, broke a few ribs in February 1923. But she continued, around this time to, she's flying, she's doing her best to fight racism. This is exactly 100 years ago. The crash I just referenced was February 22nd of 1923. She spoke to audiences across the country about aviation, but she spoke directly about the goals for African Americans, what they can and can't do. And at many of these events, they would, those that were putting the event on would occasionally try to prohibit the attendance of Black people, and if that happened, she would refuse to participate. She would just say, "Nope, if Black folks aren't allowed in, I'm not flying." Also in the 1920s, she spent some time in Orlando, Florida. She kind of sort of became adopted by, you know, very, very close family friend with a man named Reverend Hezekiah Hill and his wife. So spent some time there. They basically viewed her as an adopted daughter. She stayed there for an extended period of time, opened a beauty shop even to earn some extra money because she was hoping to buy her own plane. She didn't own her plane at this point. The plane was owned or underwritten by the Chicago Defender. So her acclaim continues to grow. She has all these contacts in the media. And then eventually she's offered a role in a feature length movie. The movie's called Shadow and Sunshine. And she accepts the role because she's hoping it's going to be the next logical step to her career, and she'll make some good money off of it. And it's probably way safer than barnstorming and walking out onto the wing of a plane. But she gets the script for this thing and realizes that the opening scene calls for her to basically appear as though she's a slave, sort of chewed up, beaten up clothes, hunched over, using a walking stick, has a pack on her back, and she refused to do it, even though it was clearly going to do great things for her. There was a newspaper writer at the time, a woman named Doris Rich, who wrote, quote, "Clearly, Bessie's walking off the movie set was a statement of principle. Opportunist though she was about her career, she was never an opportunist about race. She had no intention of perpetuating the derogatory image most whites had of most blacks," unquote. And so she proceeded with the barnstorming, been putting on these shows, basically anywhere that she was invited. April 30th, 1926, she was in Jacksonville, Florida. She had finally saved enough money to purchase a Jenny. She purchased a Curtiss JN4 in Dallas. A guy named William Wills was her mechanic and a guy that basically handled her publicity. He was a pilot as well. He flew the plane from Dallas to Jacksonville in preparation for this air show. On the way, he had to land three times because of mechanical problems, and finally got the plane to Jacksonville. Her family was encouraging her to not use the plane until it had been like thoroughly scoped out. But she refused. The day before she was due to exhibit there in Jacksonville, she went up with Wills in the plane, and was basically just going to scope out kind of the lay of the land before the show the following day. 10 minutes into the flight, the plane takes a dip and goes into a dive because she was unbuckled, and she was, she's customarily was doing these tricks and would go out and sit on the edge of the wing and do crap like that. She wasn't buckled in. She was thrown from the plane and she fell 2,000 feet to her death. Wills was unable to gain control of the plane, and he was basically in a nosedive. Plane crash, explodes on impact, and he is killed as well. The plane is scorched all to hell, but they did finally figure out that there was a wrench that was used to service the plane at some point in the process, and that wrench had jammed the controls. Coleman was 34 years old when she died. So she dies at 34, essentially right at 100 years ago. There are things that honor Bessie Coleman in Atlanta, Texas, where she was born. There's a public library in Chicago. There are roads at O'Hare International in Chicago. There's a roundabout leading to Nice Airport in the south of France. There are numerous Bessie Coleman middle schools, including one in Texas, in Cedar Hill. There's a Bessie Coleman Boulevard in Waxahachie. There is a fixed base operator, a company that basically handles baggage claim and operations at Gary Chicago International Airport. She was inducted into the National Women's Hall of Fame and the National Aviation Hall of Fame. And there was a U.S. stamp made in her honor. And later on this year, in 2023, Bessie Coleman is going to be honored with an American Woman U.S. quarter with her face on it. So I think this woman is positively exceptional and amazing and little known. The reason I wanted to mention her, especially right on or around MLK Day, is because there was one other news item that came up just recently that sent me through the roof. January 3rd of this year, there was a young guy named Keenan Anderson, who is, he happens to be the cousin of one of the founders of Black Lives Matter. He's a cousin of Patrice Cullors. Keenan Anderson has a car wreck in Los Angeles. You know, details are sketchy, and you can choose to believe whichever version of events you want to, but Keenan Anderson, 31 years old, he teaches English at a school in Washington, D.C. He's in Los Angeles. He has a car accident. He goes and seeks out police. And the incredibly short version is he is tased, pinned down, injured, you know, because he is quote unquote resisting, taken to the hospital where he dies of cardiac arrest. I just saw that and was like, what the actual fuck? I mean, it's that's why I would love to talk to someone like Martin Luther King III or anyone who works in this movement who is African-American and ask them, what do you think? Where are we exactly? You know, a few weeks ago, I brought up the story of Henrietta Lacks and the fact that she obviously wasn't heroic necessarily in her endeavors professionally, was badly taken advantage of, but she's being honored with a statue in Norfolk, Virginia, where a statue of Robert E. Lee used to stand. And I just continue to be flabbergasted by the fact that this shit just keeps fucking happening.
Again and again and again.
It's just, I don't know. So there you have it, I guess. That's the sum total of my, you know, my story this week. You know, my sort of additional caveat to this is, and I do this occasionally just to sort of reacquaint myself, but you know, you and I are both straight white men in our 50s, and we'd probably do a better job than a lot of folks in terms of engaging in a proactive anti-racist stance. But anyone who's listening to this who wants to be reacquainted with what you can do, what you should do, just, you know, go to Google, type in how to be anti-racist. There is a bottomless pit of good information out there by a whole host of writers who will kind of, you know, it's good to have that, I think, as the occasional touchstone, like, you know, what can you do? What can't you do? What should you do? How can you be an advocate? How can you be seen in the right way? So that people know your stance. Because it just seems like there are so many folks with this problem, or I guess any problem, who plug their fingers in their ears and just say, "Eh, not my problem. I'm a straight white guy. Who gives a shit?" But the whole thing just makes me livid.
Yeah, it's, I think in situations like ours, it's be a good ally, make space for others to speak, and get out of the way. Sometimes, right. You know, just. Hell of a story though, about a hell of a lady. And
yeah.
I used to think that our alma mater was the best thing to come out of Waxahachie, Texas, but clearly not. Yeah, I've heard the name before, but I didn't know the intricacies of her story. That's a great story you just gave us, Bryan, of Bess Coleman.
Yeah, and apparently Amelia Earhart was inspired by her. So I mean, so if you know, a white lady in the 30s can look at Bessie Coleman and go, wow, you know, what she was able to do literally 100 years ago was stunning. I mean, why aren't we looking at her the same way now? I don't get it.
Yeah, and another example of, and really one of the, it's probably not the earliest, but another early example of folks of color having to go to Europe for right. You know, Paris, Copenhagen to be accepted for who they were and to be able to do extraordinary things that they weren't allowed to do here in the States.
Right. Absolutely. And you know, I mean, and how long and how expensive would it have been if it's 1922 and you're in Chicago and you said, okay, I have to go to Paris. How long does that take you, and how much does that cost? I have no idea. I mean, so you take a train to New, I don't know, just just the work involved in doing that was just incredible.
Yep.
Anyway, not that funny, but interesting and maybe slightly worthwhile considering the date.
Yes, sir. Well done, Bryan. Thank you.
Yeah. So we do have a quick curse word that's kind of along the same lines.
It's time for the Dream Idiot's curse word of the week. The curse word this week is cunning stunt, as used in the sentence, Sarah Huckabee Sanders is now governor of Arkansas and had two cunning stunts in her first week.
Did you hear what Sarah Huckabee Sanders did in her first week as governor?
I know that her first her first area of action was to ban the word Latinx or Latinx from the lexicon of public discourse in the state of Arkansas.
Yeah, she did that, and she also banned CRT.
Yeah.
Well, not that anyone, I mean, genuinely, no one was clamoring for her to do either one of these things, but she had to quickly stick her neck out. And, I'm racist too. So, okay, thanks, Sarah. We knew that, but okay.
Well, I think part of one of DeSantis's plans out in Florida was to, quote, ban critical thinking. Just period, flat out. It's right. Apropos of nothing.
Right. We would appreciate it if you were more minion-like.
I would have to look into that for more information, but I believe I heard that today and was like, wait, what? That can't be right. Flat out banned critical thinking.
You're saying the quiet part out loud there.
This is a Rough Tiger production.
Bong bong, Bryan.
Bong bong?
Bong bong.
Bong bong. Good.